And now BBC Two is proud to present An Evening of Monty Python.
Thank you. And now, for my next number, I shall be using the services of a Tiddles.
Good evening, viewer. Tonight, BBC Two are celebrating the 30th anniversary of Monty Python, which is a very special occasion for us Pythons. And I'd just like to say, on behalf of the whole gang, except for the dead one, of course, how pleased we are to be back at the BBC. Of course, the relationship between us and the BBC has not always been easy, but we really are delighted to be here tonight to celebrate on BBC Two the 30th anniversary of the first ever transmission of Monty Python's Flying Circus on BBC One. Which, I suppose, speaks for itself. We've been moved down, you see, from BBC One, the more popular channel, to BBC Two, the less popular or more unpopular channel. So thank you, BBC, for this big vote of confidence. Obviously, we're just a tired bunch of pathetic old has-beens who are clearly...
In case you're interested, John's suit is made of fine brushed mohair. It's made in the new economic zone of Shanghai. So if you like it or anything else John's wearing, why not contact BBC Costumes, part of the Lufthansa Sainsbury's Aero Grocery Group.
I mean, it was fine when we were pulling an audience as a 9 minute, but now apparently we're out of touch with the sensibilities of the new so-called commercially-led television era. I mean, do you know what Eddie Izzard gets? £70,000 a show? I used to get £3,500 a series. And Monty Python changed the face of the 20th century. Bloody BBC! What are you doing?
You were criticising the BBC.
Well, don't think you frighten me with John Burt. Ha! John Burt, he's dead in the water. He'll be in the House of Lords next. John Burt.
I've got a message from Greg Dyke.
Greg Dyke!
Yeah, Greg says you better do your announcing properly, otherwise you're going to have to support yourself for the rest of your life doing Sainsbury's commercials.
Oh, no, please, don't make me work for Sainsbury's again, please. I'll do it properly. I'll be good. Shall we start again, please? I'll be really, really, really good, I promise.
That's my boy.
Let's start again. And now BBC Two is proud to present An Evening of Monty Python.
Stop it! No, stop him!
Good evening, girl.
Darn you!
Tonight, BBC Two are celebrating the very first transmission of Monty Python's... excuse me, I'm introducing this evening's themed viewing.
Yeah, well, that comes under introductions and announcements. We're BBC Furniture.
I'm sorry?
All furniture comes under BBC Central. Furnishing has to be costed and rehired out on a pro-rata basis to the user through central authorisation on behalf of the fundee, i.e. the licence payer.
Well, can I just make the opening announcement, please?
Not on that chair, you can't, no.
But it's a BBC announcement and this is a BBC chair.
No, that chair belongs to BBC Furnishing, which is now a wholly owned subsidiary of BBC Interior Design. PLC.com.
Which, in turn, is part of American Airlines.
What's happened?
It's a BBC open lighting policy. The lights can be used by anyone at any time who is willing to pay more.
But we're on the air.
Not anymore.
No. I'm Peter Sissons, and tonight at 12:30 I'll be talking live to all the surviving pythons here in the studio. It's the first time they've been together on BBC television for 25 years. So stay tuned.
Absolutely typical of the bloody BBC. Oh, hello! We've given them the cheque, but apparently they need 3 days to put it through, so I'm not quite sure what we should... Oh, good idea. Right. So, good evening, viewer, again. Will you be quiet down there? And now we're going to show you a full-length documentary about us. And I hear it's absolutely fascinating, as you'd expect. Oh.
Did you go by Calcutta?
I'm an announcer! What are you? BA298. Yes, you get into Calcutta at 2106.
Terrific.
Monty Python Story.
Jones's house, one of the six pythons. People not carved out of stone, but carved out of something else. They are python, and here on this very table, the Monty Python television series was written 30 years ago. Crazy sketches that were taken into the BBC, and the BBC said, well, all right, because they didn't know what they got, because they were fools. Here, the albatross that was round John Cleese's neck when he said, albatross, what flavors? Not any bloody flavors, bloody albatross flavor. The entire family tree from here to 30 years. Their sketches, their albums, their radio times, a matching tie and handkerchief, videos, CD-ROMs, everything. The Python story starts here, and it is a story.
The pythons came from ordinary provincial towns. Except the American one, who came from Minneapolis. They were clever, good at games, apparently. And listen to the goons.
What's that?
Oh, you hear that, Min?
What's that? What's that?
It's the war whoops of the Nakatakar Indians.
Oh, are they the ones that commit atrocities?
Yes, Min.
I'll go upstairs and get ready.
At Oxford, Michael Palin was studying history when he met English student Terry Jones. Over in Cambridge, another English student, Eric Idle, was punting with John Cleese, studying law, and medical student Graham Chapman. Terry Gilliam, the American one, was studying political science at a college in Los Angeles. Kind of funky. At university, their academic pursuits took second place to writing, performing, and being funny. In England, Peter Cook and Beyond the Fringe had proved that you could do this sort of thing for a living. There was never a better time to be clever, eccentric, witty, and looking for that first job in television.
Terry was a script advisor to the comedy department, so it meant you had to write filler material for shows with people like Russ Conway and Ken Dodd. And if we were around, we'd get roped in, and I think one of the first things I ever did with Terry was actually to appear as an extra on the Ken Dodd show.
Mike and I started writing together and writing material for Kathy Kirby's show. I remember doing Billy Cotton Banjo and things. And then Mike and I started for the Frost stuff.
Fellow Oxbridge graduate David Frost had made a great impact on television with That Was the Week That Was, and was the perfect producer to encourage new talent into the business.
Well, we were very lucky. We were the first generation who could go straight, really, from university into television. You know, before that, usually people had gone to Fleet Street or somewhere, and then moonlighted on television, and now we were the first generation to go straight into television.
Would you read what is on this card?
May every Christmas wish come true and joy this day be yours with mistletoe upon the tree and holly on the doors.
The other side.
John was the first person to get hugely famous on television through his appearances on The Frost Report with people like Ronnie Corbett.
I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Love, Dennis and Mabel.
We had so many clever writers, all new to the business and all as yet not got, none of them had got round to performing. I mean, the boys that were going to be the embryo, the Python, last of the 1948 embryo were all there. We had Michael and Terry and John Cleese and Graham Chapman. They all seemed to work in pairs. Eric Idle worked on his own quite a bit.
It was a great sort of experience, really. And particularly, I say, for Mike and I, we sort of did some studio sketches, but we he got involved with writing these little visual things, which were, I think one of the things was what happens to judges when they have a recess.
It was no surprise that John went on to take a prominent role in Frost's next program, At Last, the 1948 show. The big break for Michael, Terry G and Eric came with a kids' show produced by Humphrey Barclay, where they said, stuff the kids, let's write it for us.
It was at 5:25 in the evening, and we got a lot of adults came in from work and would switch on to us, so we were getting a great crossover audience.
Terry G had recently arrived from America in a big coat. He watched Do Not Adjust Your Set and immediately thought that the program could use some animation and that he should do it.
I went down there with my portfolio of all my drawings plus written sketches, and Humphrey turned out to be an amateur cartoonist, and he liked the cartoons. And I think he took pity on me and bought some written sketches, which he then forced on the others, much to, I think, their chagrin that this interloper had arrived, this somebody from outside was moving into their turf.
So we're there having our pints of beer after the show. And Terry Gilliam comes in, this wonderful fur coat, I just remember, all that down to his feet, and a very, very glamorous girlfriend, you know. We hated him immediately.
Eric was the most friendly. He befriends strangers quicker than the rest. And Mike and Terry, I just remember sitting in the... They were in the back of the bar, glowering, who is this guy with the big coat?
Terry had... what Terry has now, you know, this terrific energy, full of ideas, and said that he did these... animation was his thing, you know, and so I think we said, well, yeah, why not? As soon as we saw the first, I think it was the Christmas card animation he did, it was just wonderful.
Complete.
I just thought they were very, very funny. And what struck me most of all about Terry's animation, first of all, was his comic timing in them. It was so good. And the way he used sound effects. It was all very simple. It was almost like sort of child's collage effect. The drawings weren't that elaborate, you just moved things around. But it was the timing was absolutely spot on, and that's what impressed me.
ITV said to us, right, you kids are good. We're going to give you your own adult show. You're going to do 3/4 of an hour. And we said, oh, that's great. So we're having our own TV show now. But they said, well, we can't do it for another 18 months, unfortunately, because we can't give you a studio till then. Thames Television said this. And meanwhile, John and Graham came to us, and all that sort of thing happened where we suddenly did Python instead.
What Thames TV didn't realise is that saying, wait 18 months, is not as sexy as the BBC saying, hey, do you want to do it right now? So this ramshackle group of comedy gladiators were only too happy to mosey round to the Mr. Big of BBC comedy at TV Centre.
We'd met up and had this extraordinarily bad sort of job interview where we'd all been put in a room, and Michael Mills, the head of comedy, came in and said, well, what are you going to call the show? And we said, well, we don't know. Well, it's going to, you know, will it have music in it? Well, we don't know. Would it be Star Guess? We don't know. You know, hopeless. We were absolutely hopeless. And at the end of it, he stood up, looking slightly irritable, and said, all right, I'll give you 13 shows, but that's all.
I think the lovely thing was is there wasn't a sign of a spotlight on us from anywhere, and we'd been given this little sort of backwater to play in, and we never thought we'd get on before 11 o'clock on a Sunday night. So we were just able to play, and there was a sense of excitement from quite early on that we were being able to throw out all the conventions that we thought were boring. And I remember one particular meeting when we began to get a sense there was a sort of an energy running, that we were all facing in the right direction, although we couldn't have, or the same direction, we couldn't have actually defined what it was.
A lot of time was spent on deciding what to call the program. Bun, Wacket, Buzzard, Stubble and Boot was one. Arthur Megapode's Cheap Show was another. Owl's Stretching Time, my favourite. But they were all abandoned in favour of Monty Python's Flying Circus, which is complete nonsense, but which now seems like a big name in a dictionary and really quite sensible. The Pythons really planned to push the boat out in comedy terms, but just as they were about to push their boat out, they saw...
Sir William Blobbs, a clear win there by 8 bars in the key of E flat.
Comedy hero and ex-goon Spike Milligan had already pushed the boat out with his television series Q5.
Here we are for the start of the 400-meter standing still dash. Inside lane is Grandy of Ireland.
So the Pythons realized they had to push the boat out a lot further, or maybe attach a motor to the boat, or get a bigger boat.
They're off. It's Harry Gunn, the inside lane, who's making the game.
Spike suddenly exploded comedy. I suddenly realized we'd all been writing cliches in a way, and that the cliche was a 3-minute sketch which had a beginning, middle and end with a punchline, or you wrote a one-liner or what we'd call a blackout sketch, which would be like 30 seconds with one joke.
Stop! You're all wrong! It's John Bluthal of Field of Wit lost for something fame.
Spike showed that you could change, you could break this up, you could have sketches that went into other sketches, you could sort of have things that didn't have punchlines, you could play around with it.
Just a minute. Who are you? Reveal yourself! Mother!
And it made me start thinking differently. And I can just remember Terry Gilliam had done this animation for Do Not Adjust Your Set.
Elephants in War.
And he'd said, I don't know, it's a sort of stream of consciousness. It just goes from one thing to another. It's not about anything, really. I don't know whether it works.
The Elephant of Surprise.
I suddenly thought, well, maybe you could do that for the whole show. You could have live action and animation, and everything could go in and out of each other and flow on.
With this plan in mind, the Pythons began to write. Eric wrote on his own. John wrote with Graham. Terry G animated alone. And Michael wrote with Terry J. The writing partnerships were fixed, and the system democratic, though not in the classical Greek sense of the word.
Mike and I think originally we'd started by sitting opposite tables, writing together, you know, sort of word by word. But we gave that up quite early on, actually, and found that it was much more productive to write alone and then come to each other with written material, read it out, say, that's good, let's use a bit of that, put this together. And then, you know, when you're together, you just make a compilation job.
I joined up with Graham because we'd been writing stuff even together at Cambridge, which would have been 61. Gray's way of working was always to sit on the outside and then to lob an idea or a line from out of left field into the engine room, but he could never be the engine room. If you put the pad in front of Graham and gave him the pencil, nothing would happen. But his embroidering and his weird takes on things coming in from odd tangents very frequently breathed life into a sketch that was actually getting rather predictable.
We did all sort of come at our writing from different angles, I suppose. I mean, Graham and John seemed to have an obsession with animals and thesauruses and things like that he would use, you know, like the cheese shop is really just a list of great cheeses. They love reference book humour like that.
Liptauer?
No.
Lancashire?
No.
White Stilton?
No.
Danish Blue?
No.
Double Gloucester?
No.
Cheshire?
No. I suppose Terry and myself were slightly more odd and surreal and I think something like the Spanish Inquisition, for instance, could not have been written by John and Graham in quite the same way.
One on crossbeam's gone out of skew on treadle.
Pardon?
One on crossbeam's gone out of skew on treadle.
I don't understand what you're saying.
One of the crossbeams has gone out askew on the treadle.
What on earth does that mean?
I don't know. Mr. Wentworth just told me to come in here and say that there was trouble at the mill, that's all. I didn't expect a kind of Spanish Inquisition.
Nobody expects the Spanish Inquisition. Our chief weapon is surprise. Surprise and fear. Fear and surprise are two weapons. Our fear and surprise and ruthless efficiency are three weapons. Our fear and surprise and ruthless efficiency and an almost fanatical devotion to the Pope are four. No. Amongst our weaponry are such elements as fear. I'll come in again.
Eric was very much on his own, which he always felt was a little unfair because When he wrote something, in a sense, he only had one vote potentially sitting there, and I know that he felt that was unfair, but at the same time, it enabled him to control when he wanted to write, and Eric is a very independent guy. He likes that kind of freedom.
Rumpeltweezer ran the Dinky Tinky shop in the foot of the magic oak tree, by the wobbly dum-dum bush, in the shade of the magic glade, down in Dingley Dell. Here he sold contraceptives and...
Also, working on his own and pleasuring himself with a pen, paper and some scissors was Terry Gilliam.
Discipline.
I had the most freedom within the group, to be quite honest, because I couldn't describe accurately what I was doing until it was there, it was finished. It was a done thing by the time they really saw it.
This is a sweet baby.
You shouldn't let him suck on the tummy, my dear.
Oh, my God.
No!
Don't touch it!
And I was the only one in those meetings because I didn't have any written material that could be totally non-political and just laugh openly and react very immediately and simply, because others would even guard their laughter and their response to it, because if that one got in, then their thing might not get in. And so in a strange way, I became the audience.
The first programme was broadcast on the 5th of October, 1969, on BBC One at 10:55 p.m. GMT, or thereabouts. At the recording session, the real studio audience stared at them as if they were six pigs playing banjos at a bar mitzvah.
We were very nervous.
Good evening.
There weren't many laughs. The studio audience was probably in shock.
Again, and welcome to the show.
And I remember afterwards in the bar, certain people who were quite close friends saying, oh, well, no, I won't have a drink tonight. I've got to dash home, you know, babysitter. I didn't even have babies. You know, any excuse to go. So it was a touchy time. It wasn't that we all leapt in the air and said, this is a great breakthrough in world comedy. We have broken down the barriers of comedy that have been remembered for years to come. It was just, God, we got through that night and we've got another chance to do it next week.
Over the next 4 years, Python produced 4 series and 45 episodes of their hit series. Fans began to wear knotted hankies on their heads and watch the show in their millions. And there was a film of favourite sketches made, and now for something completely different. Books and records were released, and they all packed with weird, crazy writing and memorable characters that we knew would be remembered up to and including a 30-year documentary.
Well, John's obviously the cruel, heartless bastard.
Now, I know some hospitals where you get the patients lying around in bed.
Then Michael was the sweet, you know, and rather slightly ineffective lower-middle-class person.
I have a silly walk, and I'd like to obtain a government grant to help me develop it.
And Terry was the rat-bag woman.
Oh, I wet him!
And Gilliam was anything that had unpleasant makeup jobs. I suppose I played kind of, I don't know, either cheeky people, you know, or kind of up people, optimistic people who are insanely optimistic.
Are you the registrar?
I have that function.
Well, I was here on Saturday getting married to a blonde girl, and I'd like to change, please. I'd like to have this one instead.
What do you mean?
Well, the other one wasn't any good, so I'd like to swap it for this one, please. I have paid. I paid on Saturday. Here's the ticket.
Terry and I couldn't play authority figures. We're just not terribly believable. Whereas John and Graham look like eminently respectable people from the Foreign Office.
I'm afraid that the Ministry of State is no longer getting the kind of support that it needs. You see, there's defence, social security, health, housing, education, city wars. They're all supposed to be answered. But last year, the government spent less on the Ministry of State than it did on national defence.
It was a tremendous plus to be able to have people who looked like that and then did extremely silly things.
A very big welcome, please, for the Grand Minister of Pensions and the Social Security.
Graham was quite possibly the best actor of all of us. But he used to get scared because he didn't really learn the line in the first place, and then he'd get scared during the day, and then he'd go and have a couple of drinks to sort of calm his scaredness down, and then that would have the inevitable effect, and he'd have two more before we went on the air. But intrinsically, I think he was the best actor.
His new play opens at National Theatre tomorrow.
Oh, that's good.
Good? Good? What do you know about it? What do you know about getting up at 5 o'clock in the morning to fly to Paris, back at the Old Vic for drinks at 12, sweating the day through press interviews, television interviews, then getting back here at 10 to wrestle the problem of an homosexual nymphomaniac drug addict involved in the ritual murder of a well-known Scottish footballer? That's a full working day, lad.
There were quite a lot of roles that were Eric or Mike roles, and compares, greasy compares, and, you know, the awful insincere smiles, lovely to have you here.
And now a letter, a hotel registration book, and a series of photographs which could add up to divorce, premature retirement, and possible criminal proceedings for a company director in Bromsgrove.
I wasn't such a good woman. Terry was a very good woman.
Hello, Mrs. Rogers? No? Oh, I must be in the wrong house.
It's a lovely sort of homely, mum-like figure. And Eric was a slightly sort of exotic sort of spinster who'd had a bit of a naughty time sometime in her life.
Last week on Party Hints, I showed you how to make a small plate of goulash go around 26 people, how to get the best out of your canapés, and how to unblock your loo. This week, I'm going to tell you what to do if there's an armed communist uprising near your home when you're having a party.
And John was just this sort of real sort of... You know, how can I describe it, really?
How do you do?
How do you do?
The Pythons played a lot of female characters themselves, but if they ever needed a female character you were actually attracted to, they called on Carol Cleveland.
The fellas were always apologizing to me for not having more for me to do. Now, they did write very well for the older women, which they played themselves so well, far better than I could, but they couldn't write funny parts for young women.
Are you the marriage guidance counsellor?
Yes, good morning.
Morning, sir.
And good morning to you, madam.
I've only written 5 scripts to begin with, and I think I got 3 of them prior to filming. And I read through them and thought, well, some of it was very funny. Some of it admittedly went shoom right over my head. And some of it, the rest of it, I just thought was plain infantile. I mean, what is this all about? So I just threw myself into it and gradually came round to thinking, hey, this is great stuff. It's silly, it's bizarre, it's clever, it's wonderful.
What seems to be the trouble with your marriage, Mr. Pewty?
Well, it all started about 5 years ago. We started going on holiday to Brighton together. Deirdre, that's my wife, has always been a very good companion to me. Well, I never particularly anticipated any marital strife.
She was used very much in a sexual role whenever there had to be real sex. And we would nick all the other parts where you have to be just like cheeky women, you know, silly old ugly women. And she was very tolerant and very good at that. And I think she was a female. It was a stooge, largely.
You suspected your wife?
Well, yes.
2, 4, 7, 6, 4, 5. Looking back on his early work, Terry Gilliam is baffled by how he created such weird stuff.
Please, trust. When I do see them by mistake, I'm always surprised by them. I look at the animation and I'm kind of amazed by it because the guy who did it isn't me.
Henry, turn that television off! You know it's bad for your eyes!
I mean, it's somebody else that did that. I mean, I recognize some of me in it, but it's not. And I don't know how I thought of those things, quite honestly. I look at it, Jesus, how did my mind, what was my mind doing? How did I get to that point?
Despite the success of Python and the winning of a prize at the Montreux Film Festival, John had been restless for some time. And by the end of Series 3, he decided to leave the group, like a penguin leaves the other penguins and jumps into the water and swims off. Because he'd written The Frost Report for 3 years beforehand, he ran out of steam writing the 3-minute sketch much sooner than everybody else did, which is why he wanted to leave much sooner than everybody else. He'd done it.
I felt very much that we were repeating ourselves. I felt that Gray and I only wrote 2 genuinely original things in the whole of the last series, and I think they were Dennis Moore and The Cheese Shop. And I just felt that everyone else's material was also repetitive, and that if anyone said a sketch, I could say that's that sketch from the first series combined with that sketch from the second series, and a little bit of that sketch from the second series too. And once you could begin to identify sketches like that, I thought, why are we doing it? Whereas the other guys liked the process. And I was carrying Graham, and there was no chance that anyone was going to start writing with him. And I also wanted to move on.
As their TV life came to an end, the Pythons, including John, found themselves wanting to work on a bigger canvas. Seeing as they could all spell the word history, they decided to produce a film of the quest for the Holy Grail.
Charlie, you come to this mark there, to where Suto is. Suto, you can turn there.
Filming Holy Grail was just a nightmare. We had 5 weeks to film it, and we're shooting up in Scotland. And we just, I mean, everybody said, you can't shoot it in this time, and there's no way you can do it. And we just knew we just had to try and get through it all.
You can to start with.
I just remember it being cold and damp, and you could tell what time of day it was by how far the wet had soaked up your woolen armour.
We used to put on this absurd chain mail, which was nothing more than knitted string, and there was no money at all. So we'd get up on this Scottish mountain at 8 o'clock, and it would rain, and there'd be no umbrellas, and we would simply stay wet for the rest of the day. And then at 6:15, there was this mad rush to get back to the hotel because there was enough hot water for 40% of the cast and crew. It was just a nightmare. And yet, there was a good feeling that there were funny stuff, you know? If you feel you're being funny, you can put up with almost anything.
I think it was an instinct at work. We kind of knew when things were going to be right. And, I mean, Graham was, maybe by default, he got King Arthur, but he was absolutely superb. He was a really good actor, Graham.
Go and tell your master that we have been charged by God with a sacred quest. If he will give us food and shelter for the night, he can join us in our quest for the Holy Grail.
You know, there's all sort of patient, baffled, bewildered earnestness.
Well, I'll ask him, but I don't think he'll be very keen. He's already got one, you see.
What?
He says they've already got one.
Are you sure he's got one?
Oh, yes, it's very nice.
He had a problem, which we didn't really realize. Nobody realized quite how much into the alcoholism he was at the time.
Can we come up and have a look?
Of course not. You are English types.
Well, what are you then?
If you look at the outtakes, he couldn't remember a line. So it's all the outtakes would go something like this. My name is Arthur. Yes? King of the Britons. King of the Britons. Yes? Whose castle is this? I wish to see them, you know, so we were always forced to cut back to us in all these takes. But he would do his lines perfectly. It was good with Graham being the leader.
If you do not agree to my commands, then I shall...
The film did make a lot of money, and I think it made $12 million. And on the basic investment, that was a fantastic turnover.
Holy Grail was released in the States, and the Python TV series was first aired on a local network in Dallas, and then went all across the US. Everyone expected Python to sink without a trace, but weirdly, it didn't, man.
When it came on, it used to play on Sunday evenings, and it kind of replaced religion for me. That was my Sunday ritual. Sunday evenings, tune in the Pythons, and I just loved it.
I've always assumed, it's an explanation, but it's not one I'm sure about, that somehow the characters that we did were kind of archetypes because they seem to have rung bells with people, even in Japan.
You don't have to, you know, have a PhD to understand Ministry of Silly Walks. It's funny if you showed it to an 8-year-old. It's funny because it's, look at that silly walk.
I think I was in about third grade, so I was about 8 years old.
when I first saw it. And you know, the irony is that for us, that was the dirty little show that the kids weren't supposed to watch. And then, of course, we would all go to school the next day and talk about it. And you had to sneak downstairs and you know, turn it on. And if Mom caught me, she would be very angry because I was supposed to be in bed, first of all, but also just because of what I was watching, you know, because there was titties. I mean, that was the key. But it was really, you know, being 8 years old, that was my introduction to humor, really.
Python just, it gave me something like when I was growing up in like any town, USA, like just something that I felt was like mine. And I felt like it gave me like, I don't know, just some kind of edge on humor that other people didn't see. Like, I felt like, probably for not a probably wasn't a good thing, but in a cocky way, I felt like I saw humor in a bigger, better, wider way than other people who were just sitting around watching, you know, I don't even know what the hell kind of comedy was. Three's Company and stuff like that.
Although the TV series of Python was an ex-parent, by the mid-70s, the Pythons were taking part in a huge amount of acting, writing, and directing. A big old list of memorable projects. Ripping Yarns, The Ruttles, Jabberwocky, and Fawlty Towers. Even though the Pythons were now on solo projects, the success of Holy Grail and the desire to work together again produced one of the most controversial of their films, but also their happiest experience as a team.
Ryan. We did want to do another film after Holy Grail because it was beginning to make money, for one thing, and it was felt that we should try one more and get together.
At the opening of Holy Grail, when some interviewer said, "What's your next film going to be?" And I said, "Jesus Christ, Lust for Glory." And I got a big laugh.
And so we started sort of writing various little sketches that might or might not fit in, and gradually this idea of it being about somebody called Brian, who lived a life absolutely parallel to Jesus, but wasn't Jesus, but was mistaken for Jesus, came about. And Eric knew of somebody who had a house for hire in Barbados, and we all agreed to go there and write. And I remember being a little bit sort of cautious about whether we could really write in such a sort of paradise. It's a typical sort of old English granny-ish view I had of these things. It turned out to be a very successful writing period. Brian was probably the best time for us all working together. And we were out in Monastir, we were out in the sunshine. It was quite pleasant.
Brenda over here.
Brent.
We had a bit more money, so we could afford a hotel room each. And it was in Tunisia, which was quite pleasant. I think it was, and we decided that only one person should direct. And so Gilliam did the art direction, and Jonesy did the direction, and that was sort of spared them both agonies.
It was trying to find a way of working so that what I did was, you know, I did what I was good at and didn't get frustrated and crazed by the other side of it. So Terry and I split, and he directed it. And I designed it. The little spaceship sequence in the middle was a way of escaping from animation and do live action stuff with models and special effects and learning how to do it. We didn't have any special effects people, so we went down to the local joke shop, bought all these exploding cigars, emptied the gunpowder out, took a light bulb, broke the glass part using the filament as the sparking device, and made the explosion. It was great because we had nothing, no money, no time, and we just had to fake it. And it's always been, to me, the best way of learning under those conditions, rather than being given everything and going out there with the best technicians, with the best designers. And you know, you don't learn that way. I mean, my attitude is always try to learn by making the mistakes myself.
Oh, you lucky bastard.
By this time, Graham had become a reformed character. He'd stopped being this, you know, enormously messed up alcoholic. And his real natural character came out, and he was finally able to do things without alcohol and learn his words. And he knew all his words suddenly. He didn't have to fight his nerves with this dreadful alcohol thing. So he was a sort of saint on Brian. He really was.
Let me speak to them, Pontius. Good idea, Biggus.
We had to have this crowd laughing at Graham's speech in Pillamont as a lithpup, and Mike as somebody who can't pronounce his R's. So we got in a Tunisian comedian along. We thought, well, we'll get him talking and then we'll shoot them.
laughing, and of course it didn't really work, really. So after a while, I sort of I got up and I said to the assistant director, I said, just tell them to do what I do, right? So he's, and I sort of started laughing hilariously, and then fell on my back and wagged my legs in the air. And to my absolute delight, the entire 500 all laughed anyway, because of, and then fell on the floor and waggled their legs in the air, and they thought they'd never had such a good time in their life. And the dust rose, and it looked wonderful. But of course, we weren't turning over because I was just asking them trying it out, you know. And then we shot it, but it was never quite as funny as that first moment, I'm afraid. They never laughed quite the same way.
Was it something I said?
Even though Brian had a strong storyline, the great sketches or scenes still jump out at you.
This man commands a quack legion. Quack! He wags as high as any in Rome. No one is to stone anyone until I blow this whistle. Do you understand? Even, and I want to make this absolutely clear, even if they do say Jehovah.
He's not the Messiah. He's a very naughty boy. Now go away.
What's this then? Romanes eunt domus. People call Romanes, they go the house.
It says Romans go home.
No, it doesn't. All right, but apart from the sanitation, the medicine, education, wine, public order, irrigation, roads, the fresh water system and public health, what have the Romans ever done for us?
I'm Brian of Nazareth.
What?
Yeah, I'm Brian of Nazareth.
Take him down.
I'm Brian of Nazareth.
I'm Brian. I'm Brian.
The Pythons called their film The Life of Brian, but to many Christians, they thought it was the life of Jesus. But Jesus is a very different spelling to Brian.
I never felt really threatened by sort of people close to home until I suppose that John and I went on this late night programme where it was debated with Malcolm Muggeridge and the Bishop of Southwark.
I simply don't think it was worthy of you. It was the sort of thing, as I say, that at Cambridge the footlights did on a damp Tuesday afternoon, or the lower fourth when I was a schoolmaster.
When we had that confrontation with Southwark and Muggeridge, my experience was that I quite enjoyed it. And it was because I felt that we were winning the argument.
400 years ago, we would have been burnt for this film. Now, I'm suggesting that we've made an advance.
Well, I'm suggesting.
So I quite enjoyed it, and it was only afterwards I discovered how angry and upset Michael had felt.
But this is such a tenth-rate film that I don't believe that it would disturb anybody's faith.
Yes, I know you started with an open mind, I realise that.
I certainly...
I knew this was wrong as we were doing it. I knew, all right, criticise us, attack us, give us a hard time, but don't dismiss us, which they were trying to do, and there was a lot of hands together and said, well, I don't think... And I think Mervyn Stockwood, the Bishop of Southwark, said in the end...
You'll get your 30 pieces of silver, well, I'm quite sure.
The adverse publicity only served to make the film even more popular and high profile. Meanwhile, going from strength to strength, the Pythons carried on with their varied and successful solo careers. Michael began his travel programs, Terry G directed Time Bandits, and together all the Pythons performed live at the Hollywood Bowl. Once again, the lure of working together proved to be strong, but the writing wasn't as easy for their fourth film, The Meaning of Life. It's the meaning
of life. I think the writing on Meaning of Life was quite hard, I think. It wasn't quite the same as it had been. And also making the film. I mean, it was like Meaning of Life. In all the other films, everybody was always around, and it was always possible to get people to chip in and consult with people. Meaning of Life was very much everybody filmed it and went off and did their own things. And so it was didn't feel quite so much of a group effort in a way.
I never enjoyed Meaning of Life. I always regarded that entire film as a bit of a cock-up.
It didn't have the smooth... development dynamic that something like Life of Brian had. We had to keep pushing it. You got stuck in the middle of the road. Oh, write a few more sketches, push it a little further towards the end. And eventually we got 90 minutes or 100 minutes, whatever we got. And I don't think it holds together as well as other Python films, but I think it contains in things like sort of Mr. Creosote, for instance, some of the most extraordinary images that we've done and some of the funniest material.
Ah, good afternoon, sir. And how are we today?
Better.
Better?
Better get a bucket. I'm going to throw up.
Gaston, a bucket for monsieur.
One of the sketches that didn't work when we first read it out was the Mr. Creosote sketch, is the fat man throwing up in the restaurant. I think it was just after lunch and we Mike read it out and it just, nobody thought it was funny. It was just one of those things that just went to the bottom of the pile. And I felt, Mike and I were convinced that was one of our funniest sketches. And that went to the bottom of the pile. And then about a month later, John rang me up and said, oh, yeah, Little Plum, I think something can bring a smile to your face. I've just read that Mr. Creosote sketch. I think it could be really funny. And then he and Graham wrote the Wafer Thin Mint thing for the ending.
And finally, monsieur, a wafer thin mint.
Bah.
Oh, sir, it's only a tiny little thin one.
Now, fuck off, I'm full.
Oh, sir. It's only a wafer thin.
Look, I couldn't eat another thing. I'm absolutely stuffed. Bugger horse.
Just one.
Just one.
Just the one, monsieur. Voila. Bon appétit.
The film looks really good. And it won the jury prize at Cannes, which was fabulous too. We played it, and on the jury, we played Mr. Creosote, and on the jury was Orson Welles, who at that time was closest to being Mr. Creosote in real life than anybody possibly, eating with both hands, I think. And they voted it the jury prize. They wanted to make it the best film. And one of the writers on there said, no, you can't do this. So we only got the jury prize. Damn them bastards.
With The Meaning of Life now completed, the Pythons were hitting their stride in their solo careers. As ever, the projects were many and varied. Books, travel programs, films directed, written, a whole bunch of stuff. With perfect comic timing, on the eve of their 20th anniversary, Graham Chapman ceased to be.
I was very, very glad, you know, one's so fortunate when this is possible, actually to be there when he died. Michael and I were there, and Peter Cook, I think, and David Sherlock, of course, and I think there were one or two others. And somehow being there and then having that amazingly cathartic memorial service afterwards, one felt that one had been through it.
And I guess that we're all thinking how sad it is that a man of such talent, of such capability for kindness, of such unusual intelligence, should now so suddenly be spirited away at the age of only 48, before he'd achieved many of the things of which he was capable, and before he'd had enough fun. Well, I feel that I should say nonsense. Good riddance to him, the freeloading bastard, I hope he's fine.
For the Pythons today, demand is still high, pulling them all off in different directions. But what everyone still wants to know is, will the Pythons ever work together again? The question kind of pisses them off, but it still hangs over them like a large albatross wearing a big woolly jumper.
We got an offer to do a 6-week tour of American cities and with a $10 million guarantee, and we were going to have film festivals in each city before we got there, and then they would have all the books, the records, and we would just come in and we'd do Python, say goodbye. And everybody had said yes to this, and then Michael came back from one holiday and said no, you know, and he went... So at that point, I realised that we would never, ever agree on anything ever again.
There is pressure always to reform, and I think probably something that one should resist. But that's been an unpopular view in the last year, one which I have held. And it gets other Pythons a bit ratty, but I think it's probably best remember us for all the good work that we did than clamber up on stage and sort of crutches and with sort of medical support and try and do the sketches all over again.
It is fun to be together, and we do have a good time when we finally get together, but it's just such a nightmare getting everybody together that it's life's too short in the end.
What worries me is there's a standard that we're going to be measured by. It's the one we set, and that's dangerous. And I think there's nothing more embarrassing than a bunch of middle-aged old farts trying to recreate the halcyon days of Python humor.
Maybe in 3 years' time, the spirit will change, or we'll all think we'll be dead soon, so we'll do so. I don't know. But not in the foreseeable future.
I think, actually, as far as a reunion is concerned, this is it. Sorry, chaps.
So, how do you end a documentary like Python? Because Python believed in no endings. No endings, man. So, I thought, here, we should have no ending. No. You know, we're not going to stop. We're not going to say stop. We can't, because you'd expect that. That's predictable. Documentary end, you know, but no, we're just going to go. Where Terry's at? Terry Jones is at. He's upstairs. He's at him, his wife Alison upstairs. You know, we don't get out of him. We told him to shut up earlier. So it's not going to end. It's not going to end in honor to Python, man. Just going to.
That was really good. That was 45 seconds, that was the right length.
We haven't finished yet, we're still going.
That's good.
So how do we end?
No. Just go upstairs, turn left in Area 14, take the down escalator up to departures, follow the signs for the North European Super Lounge, take the elevator to gates 31 to 37, turn right, check into gate 41B by 1604 at the latest, and don't pick your nose. Welcome to BBC2, or Boobie2, as I call it. The Pythons are often accused of being sexist and only writing parts for Glamour Girls. Well, what a load of bollocks! What the hell's wrong with a bit of glamour? If you've got a halfway decent pair of Bristols, let the world know about it, I say. You should see the faces of the Board of Governors when I come in a room and bask in a pair of rubber lallies, and I'm 82. Well, anyway, I've been brought in to read the weather and to answer allegations that the BBC is dumbing down. Well, are we dumbing down? We referred this to one of our focus groups.
Is the BBC dumbing down?
No! 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 We'd like to see more programmes about bricks!
We're an out-of-focus group, and we'd like to see more mindless violence.
Absolutely.
I'd like to see more mindful violence.
I'd really, really love to see someone drown.
I'd like to see mere stereotype Scotsman on the television. Just a wee dog and Doris, just a wee yin, that's all. Just a wee dog.
I'd like to see that nice Michael Palin doing one of his travel programs. You know, when he says, hello, I'm Michael Palin, and they say, oh, hello, Michael, how are you? And he says, oh, I'm very, very well, thank you. What a nice hat you have. And they say, oh, do you like it? Would you like to come in? And he says, oh, good idea, and so on and on and on and on and on. And on.
You're so restful.
Restful, oh, yes. You never get anxious or interested or anything.
Yeah, that's what we want to see.
Yes!
And so you shall.
Oh, a fairy.
You're a shagging fairy.
Shut the fuck up. And so you shall.
Oh, I am.
Barely 5 miles from the BBC's television centre here in West London is a land rarely visited by tourists and travellers. Yet behind these neat-clipped hedges, net curtains and trim front doors, an extraordinary culture once briefly flourished. This is Python Land. Oh, hello. I filmed here once a long time ago. Just wonder if I could come in and have a look around.
Yeah, all right.
Thanks. That's very much. Four, five, six milkmen in here. Thanks very much. By the way, I've got something to put on the wall. Is that all right?
You do what you like. It's not my house.
Python Land, the extraordinary always happened in the most ordinary places.
Two vicious gangs of keep left signs.
Red bus, stop it. This room's got silly.
Due to budgetary constraints, the heartland of Python was never more than a short bus ride from Television Centre. One local street rich in Python heritage is Thorpe Bank Road, Shepherd's Bush.
694. Like this.
And I've seen
that. That must be the new gas cooker!
Hello, hello, I'm Michael Palin.
Hello, hello!
May we talk
I
to you a moment?
I recognise your face.
Well, that's very nice. Why? What do you recognise me from?
I don't know.
That's the trick question. It was a long time ago. 30 years ago, I came to this house with a team of reprobates, comedians, and we played a sketch here. We tried to sell someone a gas cooker.
Could I speak to Mrs. G. Crump, please?
Oh, does nobody hear of that name? It's Mrs. G. Pinnett, 46 Edgington Road.
Well, it says Crump here, done it, Harry.
Yeah, it's on the invoice.
Yeah, it's definitely Crump.
Well, there must have been a mistake because the address is right and that's definitely the cooker I ordered.
Do you know if there's anyone in this particular area who would remember the filming that we did here 30 years ago?
30 years ago? Well, the person I know who's been here longer than that is my neighbour next door, yeah. Joe.
Joe Lyons. Hello, excuse me, Michael Palin from the Monty Python team. Oh, you do? Oh, well, I'm
going to
waste my breath. Very nice to see you, Joe.
I remember when I
yes.
found some...
Yeah,
there
well,
you
your neighbour
yeah,
your neighbor here.
They ran in my passage, didn't they?
Yes.
Terry Jones.
But you remember it?
I remember it, yeah. Right. I was coming home from work. Yes. These chaps were dressed up as guest inspectors, weren't they?
Yeah.
That's right, aren't they?
What about Tarpnell?
You
remember that?
And then these chaps with the brown overalls, you remember them?
Yeah.
They run down here, well, they did, and they walked slow, and they threw the camera up.
That's right, well, yeah, probably they did. I mean, we had about 20 people all in the same outfit trying to sell someone a gas cooker. Yeah. Oh, that's
been on any travels lately?
Well, only around Thorpe Bank Road.
Hello.
So, here we are, look, that's what we're going to give you. Absolutely free of charge.
Lovely.
No rental.
Oh, that is
that's
gorgeous.
It, you put on the side of your house.
Brilliant.
All right,
thank
so
you.
I'm going to leave you with that, and I'm going to try and go across the road and see that. What was the shop?
The corner shop, that's right.
I'm sorry about this.
That's
it's a gross intrusion. I'm Michael Palin, and we're looking around at some of the old sort of locations that we shot Python in. And did you know this was actually a corner shop, a little grocer's?
It used to be a shop, I sold it about 3 years ago. Yeah,
was it?
Yeah. Just converted just a little while ago.
Well, a very, very important Python sketch began here. Probably hardly born when Python began, I should think.
Well, I didn't think
must be 1969 this was we worked here.
That was about 7 years before I was born.
Yeah. we do have actually a wall plaque which if you would like it we can put on your wall commemorating the great event. Is that okay?
That would be wonderful.
Oh,
love that.
Well, here we go. There you are, you see. It must adorn your property in all weathers.
A short, silly walk down the Uxbridge Road takes you into darkest Python land, the London borough of Ealing, an area known for courageous exploits and valiant endeavours.
Climbing, the world's loneliest sport, where hardship and philosophy go hand in glove. And here, another British expedition attempting to be the first man to successfully climb the north face of the Uxbridge Road.
But nothing's ever quite what it seems to be in Python land. The part of the Uxbridge Road was in fact here played by the South Ealing Road. It was in this very gutter that Graham Chapman gave one of his finest performances.
Bert, how's it going?
Oh, it's a bit gripping, is this, Chris? I've got to try and reach that bus stop in an hour or so, and I'm doing it by... Damn! I'm doing it by layback up this gutter. So I'm kind of guttering and laying back at the same time and philosophising.
Bert, some people say this is crazy.
Well, they said Crippin was crazy, didn't they?
Well, Crippin was crazy.
Oh, well, there you are then. John, I'm sending you down this carabiner on white.
Well, you'll see how this part of Python land has come down a bit in the world since then. And you can tell how long ago we shot it by the number of cars on the road.
Such quiet courage is typical of the way these brave chaps shrug off danger. Like it or not, you've got to admire the skill that goes into it.
Why was it exactly that the Python team kept coming back to places like Acton High Street here? They were perhaps making some subconscious acknowledgement of their own suburban upbringing. They're perhaps making a cry of protest on behalf of a disaffected generation.
They've seen their children grow up and become accountants, stockbrokers, and even sociologists. And they begin to wonder, is it all really...
Push you, you know, shove you off the pavement, like. There's usually four or five of them.
Yeah, this used to be a nice neighbourhood before the old ladies started moving in. Nowadays, some of them don't even go out to the shops.
Well, Mr Johnson's son, Kevin, he don't go out anymore. He comes back from resting and locks himself in his room.
Favourite targets for the old ladies are telephone kiosks.
When it comes to anonymous parts of London, Lammas Park Road West 5 must come pretty near top of the list. Nothing much has happened here for over 1,000 years. But this was a veritable Hollywood of Python film locations, a place so dull that almost anything that happened seemed exciting.
This man is no ordinary man. This is Mr. F.G. Superman. To all appearances, no different from any other law-abiding citizen. Mr. F.G. Superman has a secret identity. When trouble strikes, at any time, at any place, he is ready to become Bicycle Repairman.
But Bicycle Repairman was a finely crafted, multi-locational sketch. Cut to a leafy English lane beneath the Heathrow flight path. Cut with no regard to expense to a laundrette in Acton.
Hey, there's a bicycle broken. Up the road!
Thanks. This sounds like a job for Bicycle Repairman. But how to change without revealing my secret identity?
If only Bicycle Repairman were here!
Wait! I think I know where I can find him. Look! Over there!
Bicycle Repairman!
But how? It's Bicycle Repairman! From Lammas Park Road, you can catch a bus to almost anywhere in Python Land. Oddly enough, the Japanese have produced a guide to Python places in London. It shows the inexplicable international interest in such amazingly dull places. But they do mention one of my favourite Python spots, which is Teddington Lock. I'm going to try and see if I can get there using this map. Sounds like the stop.
Yes, I am.
Yeah, oh, I'm very pleased to meet you. I did a very silly thing here about, about 30 years ago.
Oh, right.
With the Monty Python team. I don't know right. if anyone remembers it here.
I do. I remember the fish slapping one, yes. I've obviously looked into that since I've been working down there.
Right. Because you're in the book, you know, you're in this little book here.
Are we?
About, yes, a Japanese guidebook says number 23, that's Teddington Lot.
No, I haven't seen that.
That's amazing, because you were John Cleese's, you see that?
Right.
I was here. Do-do-do. I did that, yeah. That's a hell of a fall. Must have been crazy.
Very little of the early filming went much beyond the borders of Python Land. Our final destination was an exception. Thanks to a special off-peak railway excursion fare, Monty Python was allowed a 90-mile day trip to Poole Harbour in Dorset. And it was here that we filmed this, the very first image of the very first Monty Python show ever to be broadcast, at 10:55 on the evening of Sunday, October the 5th, 1969.
Monty Python's Flying Circus.
Well, I've worked out that the place on the beach here where I emerged all those years ago was just about here. The shot itself should have been completely easy. All I had to do was actually walk into the water, get to a point where the water was deep enough, submerge, and wait for someone to call action. The trouble was that the beach itself is actually quite shallow. So I had to keep walking until I actually got underneath the water. So it took me further and further and further and further and further and further still. Now this was the spot. Yes, I can feel the shell under my right foot, the same shell I started from 30 years ago, and I had to go down under the water, wait for the director to shout action, come up and emerge towards the beach. So, here goes.
Action. Action. Michael.
Yes, but what I want to know is, did he drown?
And just to remind you, the climax of this evening's viewing, I'll be in conversation here in the studio with all the surviving pythons. So stay tuned and stay up.
Dumbing down, phooey. Dumbing up, I call it.
Dumbing about.
Dumbing around.
Dumbing sideways.
Dumbing up.
Dumbing
down.
Dumbing
up.
Hello and welcome to Mastermind, which was very popular once. Our first contender tonight, I've started so I'll finish, is Mr. Onan van der Goy of Leicester. Mr. van der Goy, you've chosen as your special subject mathematical problems, to which the answer is 2. You have 5 minutes starting from now.
2!
No, you must let me ask the question first.
2!
Will you wait for the question, please?
2!
Mr. de Goy, wait for the question, please.
2!
No, Mr. de Goy.
2!
Yeah, I know you know the answer, I have to ask you the question.
2!
These are the rules. Mr. van der Goy.
2!
I haven't asked. Please?
2!
No.
Two.
Mr. van der Goy.
2!
Stop.
2!
Please?
2! 2!
I do!
Oh! Bloody Diane Fossey and all that save the gorillas lot. I mean, it's nice to have the money,
But how many TVs and air fucking miles does a gorilla need?
Yeah, I suppose you're right.
I mean, we don't need a shopping channel or a fourth-run film channel or a sports premium up your arse, 25 quid a bloody month, to see your team get beaten by Manchester United channel.
Yeah, but I like the documentaries.
All we need is a pile of leaves and somewhere to shit. We don't need fucking television.
I don't think it's been as good since Des Lynam left, anyway.
If they really want to save us gorillas, they'd send us the guns and let us defend ourselves.
What, against Des Lynam?
No, against poachers.
Oh. Is Des Lynam a poacher?
He's been poached by ITV.
Oh. Look, shut up about Des Lynam. We're gorillas.
Are we?
I thought we were orangutans.
We are not orangutans. We don't look remotely like orangutans.
Well, you don't look much like a gorilla.
Look, if you spent less time watching that rubbish, you wouldn't forget who you are. Let's throw it away.
Oh, no, no, there might be a special, 30 years of Des Lynam or something.
Oh, Christ. I'm going skiing.
Was that a punchline?
Not a Monty Python.
This is Peter Sissons reminding you that at 12:30 I'll be talking to the Monty Python team, their first time together on BBC for a quarter of a century. So, stay tuned.
Next on BBC Two, a chance for you all to vote on your all-time favourite comedy show. Just phone the number if one of these is your favourite show. And now, comedy shows made before John Birch was Director General.
And now over on BBC One, the 9 o'clock news. Lots of stories about British people complaining about things and ferries sinking in the Philippines. While here on BBC Two...
It's not fair.
What?
It's not fair.
What isn't?
They always get to be BBC One.
We're just as good.
But they are BBC One.
Well, only because they say they are. I mean, we should be BBC One sometimes.
Yes, our turn.
All right. This channel is now BBC One.
For the rest of the evening.
And tomorrow.
So, despite what they're saying over on BBC One...
On
BBC Two, this is BBC One.
Most people could tell you exactly where they were the moment they first saw Monty Python. In front of a screen. That shows just how memorable it was. Since then, the individual members have all gone on to become quite elderly people. In one case, even further. But little is known of Monty Python himself, the man who created the myth. A man who has been kept hidden away from the limelight by the selfish bastards of the Monty Python gang, perhaps the most ruthless band of self-centred comedians ever let loose on the planet. Who was this gentle man who now lives alone and slightly gaga in Harpenden? Who was Monty Python? Monty was educated at Old Queen's College, Cambridge, and when war broke out, he volunteered for the Women's Royal Army Corps. But his legs weren't good enough, and they put him in ENSA, the British Entertainment Unit. After the war, he began searching the colleges and public schools of England for a certain type of boy. But he was arrested and given 2 years in panto. After he came out in 1962, he began to hang around Oxford and Cambridge, and finally struck gold. Saving John Cleese from a life of crime, he was going to become a lawyer, Graham Chapman from a ghastly career as a doctor, and successfully preventing Michael Palin from becoming a TV travel journalist for many years. He found Terry Gilliam in a flea market in Afghanistan. Terry Jones was hiding half naked in a dustbin in India, and Eric Idle was discovered at an all-girls school in Reading, where he claimed to be studying lipstick, underwear and the matron for an article in Spank magazine. These were the boys he was looking for. He went straight to the BBC and showed them certain photographs. The rest is history. In October 1969, Monty Python limped onto British television screens. Almost everybody who saw it did. There could be no doubt about it. It was a TV show. Pampered and spoiled, the cast soon became monsters. Maddened by success, they began to deny that Monty Python even existed. So, what about the real Monty Python? Is he still alive today? Well, technically, yes. He's on a wife support system in an old jokes home in Surrey. When reached for tonight's tribute, he said, "Who?" and asked for a new bedpan. So the legendary wit has not dimmed with the passing of time and his colon. How fitting it would be if to celebrate 30 years of his show, he were to be knighted by the Queen. What could be a more fitting tribute than if he finally became Sir Monty Python? Thank you.
Silly, silly, silly. I'm not having things getting silly. Now, nobody likes a good laugh more than I do. Except perhaps my wife and some of her friends. Oh, yes, and Captain Johnson. Come to think of it, most people like a good laugh more than I do, but that's beside the point. Now, let's have a good, clean, healthy outdoor sketch. Get some air into your lungs.
So don't forget, in the studio at 12:30, I'll be talking to the entire Monty Python team. So wherever you are, stay tuned to BBC Two.
One. Excuse me.
That's mine.
No, it isn't. Everything thrown away here is property of the BBC. Can't you read?
But I like Joanna Trollope!
Be quiet. Now, what is this?
Oh!
Monty Python's contribution to Euro Show 71, a showcase of the best of European TV variety. Oh, no wonder it's on the rubbish dump. Still, it'll do for this evening.
In the midst of this green and pleasant land of sleepy hamlets and quiet rivers, peace has reigned for 1,000 years. For this is the country of Shakespeare, of Keats, and of Sir Norman Fowler. This is England. And here too in England, it is May Day, a day which is still celebrated in the English village as it has been for 1,000 years. Here, beneath the spreading chestnut trees, stout yeomen in customary dress greet the coming of the spring with folk dances of great charm and antiquity. In this village, the time-honored maypole customs survive, as the famous Morris dancers weave their patterns around their May Queen to the sound of fiddle and flute. But why is May Day celebrated in this way?
The whole point about May Day is... I'm sorry, I've forgotten what I was going to say. The whole point about May Day is... Oh, yes, the whole point about May Day is the symbolic reaffirmation of life represented in this country by a rich variety of folk customs.
In the ancient town of Lowestoft, they still celebrate May Day with the traditional fish-slapping dance. In Beccles in Suffolk, May Day is marked by the traditional gavotte of the Long John Silvers, reliving the days when pirates ruled the seas. And in Hereford, nothing happens at all. In Bolton, Lancashire, May Day means the annual return of the overdue library book, a much-loved ceremony that somehow captures the spirit of all that is most colourful, exciting, and indeed exotic in the north of England. While in the city and county of Bristol, it's nun-boiling week. and people in North Somerset join the people of Hereford in just hanging around for a bit. In the industrial conurbation of Batley, the Townswomen's Guild celebrates the 1st of May in a very special way with their reinterpretation of the renewal of all forms of life in the miracle called spring. While people in Leighton Buzzard join the people from Hereford and North Somerset in doing bugger all. But what about Sweden? The city of London also reflects the spirit of joy through rebirth at its world-famous stock exchange, where May Day is honoured by the spring dance of the futures brokers. This charming variation on the traditional merchant banker's hornpipe expresses the deepest yearning of all financiers for more and more money. This strangely touching dance offers up, in a surprising climax, a fervent prayer that one day each financier shall find some meaning in his life outside this round of eternal acquisition, and that this meaning shall bring him liberation from the whole grisly process. Elsewhere in the city, the casual visitor may be lucky enough to glimpse the traditional Maytime plummet of the bankrupt company chairman. Sport, of course, has its place at May Day, but whereas scoring was once largely a heterosexual process, in recent years the celebrations have developed into dances that have little to do with fertility and procreation. Oh, dear. Meanwhile, at the Albert Hall in London, people from all over the Commonwealth gather to watch a display of all-in cricket. And so, as the spirit of May Day spreads over the length and breadth of Britain, people gather to send greetings. Leicestershire gynaecologists gather to send greetings to gynaecologists everywhere. In Dumbarton, Scottish beekeepers gather to send greetings to beekeepers everywhere, except in Spain. And in Stafford, ambulance men send greetings to ambulance men everywhere. And people in Leighton Buzzard join the people who are standing around in North Somerset and in parts of Rutland, who have got together with the people from Hereford in order to send greetings to people in all parts of the world everywhere who are doing very little on the whole. This, then, is May Day in our land.
I'm sorry that wasn't very good, but at least you hadn't seen it before. Unlike most BBC programmes, which aren't very good either, but which you have seen before. Now, next on BBC Two...
No, I won't take that.
No, this is the property of the BBC and American Airlines.
Oh, I cleaned the gob off it.
What?
Yeah, a bloke had gobbed all over it, flung it in a bin, I cleaned it up.
Oh, take it away. Sorry about that. Now, next on BBC Two...
Do you want to come back to my place?
What?
Do you want to come back to my place?
Oh, all right.
Oh, great.
Now, you will shower, won't you?
I have showered. You've seen me before. What do you like to be, on top or underneath?
Hi, I'm Matt Stone.
And I'm Trey Parker, and here's a South Park tribute to Monty Python. Can I help you?
Yes, I wish to complain about the friend I purchased not half an hour ago from this very boutique.
Oh, yes, the Kenny. What's wrong with him?
I'll tell you what's wrong with him, my lad. He's dead.
No, he's resting.
Look, asshole, I know a dead friend when I see one, and I'm looking at one right now.
No, he's not dead, he's resting. Remarkable friend, Kenny, isn't he? Great loyalty.
Loyalty doesn't enter into it. He's stone dead.
No, he's resting.
All right, then. If he's resting, I'll wake him up. Hello, Kenny! I've got $10 for you, Kenny!
There, he moved.
No, he didn't. That was you hitting him.
I never.
Yes, you did.
No, he didn't.
Yes, he... What was that?
What was what?
Why, nothing. Go back to bed.
What the hell's going on? Oh, it's you. All right, buddy. You stop that right now. This is our show.
Hey, I'm not fat. I'm big boned.
No, you're not. You're bleeding fat.
You shut up, hippie.
Put me down.
Stop that.
Tell this little fat kid to piss off.
I'm not fat. I'm big boned.
Did you like that? Good, because we want to do a whole lot more of those.
Well, the problem is we don't have time. We'd like to get someone like Terry Gilliam to do South Park for us. Yeah, but now he's a big Hollywood director, and he doesn't really have time. That's why we kidnapped his mother. Zoom out, cameraman. Say hi to Terry, mommy.
Terry, please help me.
Shut your hole! That's enough out of you!
I'm not going to be.
You will come work for us, Terry Gilliam, or we'll use your mother's DNA to duplicate you. And to many other little Terry Gilliams that will come work for us.
Shut up!
I'm not going to.
Shut your mouth!
Mrs. Gilliam is still missing. So if anyone finds her, would they please return her to her son Terence, who is worried stiff? Postage and packaging will be refunded so long as she's posted within the EC or the Republic of Ireland. And in a reusable envelope. Thank you.
And I'd like to say we got the bloke who did the job up in the chemist's. He won't walk again, believe me. And I'd like to say I got the Rotherham baby strangler.
I got the Rotherham baby strangler.
Who broke his fingers?
My boy's found the fingers in the bag.
Oh, but who done the thumb?
You're about as much use for fart in a bottle.
Please, on television, please.
Only one item to go before this evening's grand finale, in which I will be talking live to the Pythons for the first time ever. So stay tuned.
From spam to sperm, Monty Python's greatest hits includes all the great numbers, now compiled into one great album. You remember.
Every sperm is sacred. Every sperm is good.
And who could forget?
I'm a lumberjack and I'm okay. I sleep all night, I work all day.
He's a lumberjack. He's
also
a
featuring the hit single.
Always look on the light side of life.
From spam to sperm, Monty Python's greatest hits. Only available in the next 30 minutes.
Rock fame is a funny old thing. Sure, you can make money out of garbage or 24-karat gold. But it is given only to the very few to manage to do both at the same time. And tonight, we're looking at the greatest of them all. A group who didn't even know that they were destined to become rock legends. And hell, they didn't even write their most famous piece of music.
There's a man called Roger Last, who is an assistant on the show, and he brought in these albums, and one of them was John Philip Sousa. And then Liberty Bell came on, and that's it. It's, I don't know why. It was something about that bong, the punctuation of that bell at the start that says, time to go.
Monty Python's Flying Circus!
Rather like the title being Monty Python's Flying Circus, which meant nothing. He wanted music that really meant nothing, didn't give any clue as to what it might be like, and it was desperately important that it wasn't comedy music. So we went for something completely against type, and we thought, a silly comedy show, give it some heroic quality.
At the end of the second series of Monty Python's Flying Circus, musical history took an extraordinary twist.
We did use music when sketches had sort of run their normal course and had nowhere else to go. Like, Spam is a wonderful example.
What you got, then?
Well, there's egg and bacon, egg, sausage and bacon, egg and Spam, egg, bacon and Spam.
There was really nothing except a sort of list on a menu of people, egg and Spam, egg, beans and Spam, Spam, egg, Spam, 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 egg, Spam, Spam.
Spam, 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 baked beans, Spam, Spam, Spam and Spam. Oh, lobster thermidor.
We were in a sketch which got stuck on this particular object, and a song rescued us.
Could I have egg, bacon, spam and sausage without the spam?
Yeah.
What do you mean? I don't like spam!
Spam, 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 spam.
It is just stupid. I mean, there's no reason for anything. Why are the Vikings there? Why are they dressed as Vikings? Why are they singing love songs to pressed meat?
Can't have egg, bacon, spam and sausage without the spam!
Why not?
No! It wouldn't be egg, bacon, spam and sausage, would it? I don't like spam!
Oh, well, we were told we've got to be Vikings.
Your spam. I love it. I'm having spam, spam.
I felt extremely silly and extremely hot. And so did us all.
Spam, spam. Baked beans are off!
But I think we had discreet pints of beer hidden about our persons just to keep off the worst rigors of the heat.
Can I have spam instead?
You mean spam, 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 spam,
yes!
Spam! Spam!
Years ago, I think it was after the second series of Python, I was with my wife in Greece, and we were traveling around with a little tent and on a campsite, and woke up one morning hearing people in the neighboring tent singing spam, 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 spam. And so it had started fairly early on, you know, these songs spreading out and infecting innocent people.
Spam, 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 spam.
I think we were all a bit nervous about doing this kind of thing originally. I certainly remember being very nervous about singing in the TV studio.
All of us within the group enjoyed music and songs, and most of us at the time were tone deaf.
Eric, I think, you know, Eric actually had a sort of decent voice. Terry Jones, oh dear, well, it's all right if it was a Welsh song, I suppose, and very loud and raucous and, you know, over the top. Terry Gilliam, sing?
I've got two legs from my hips to the ground, and when I lift them, they walk around.
Graham howls very, he used to howl beautifully, you know, woo, those kinds of noises.
Oh, I have had a morning.
Which, you know, have their own musical, you know, importance. John is absolutely useless.
I'm probably the worst singer in Europe. I won't compete for North America. I always have been. I was kicked out of singing lessons by Mr. Hickley and I had to do extra Greek.
John is not very comfortable singing, I don't think. I don't think he's very comfortable with music. Probably like I was. He had a sort of musical upbringing but wasn't absolutely naturally, tone perfect.
In a world where even the most talented vocalists struggle for success, this musically challenged group unwittingly pulled off one of the cult classics of the century.
Mike and I had been writing all day this sketch about a barber, the psychotic barber. Snip, 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 snip.
How would you like it, sir?
Oh, just short back and sides, please.
How do you do that?
Oh, just ordinary short back and sides.
It's not a razor cut. Razor, 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 razor cut! The spurred artery murder!
And we just couldn't think of a way of getting out of it or finishing it.
And I think one of us must have said, like, why don't you just say...
I didn't want to be a barber anyway. I wanted to be a lumberjack.
Or something, and it just came out almost as it is now in a very short time. By 7:15, we'd written it down and we're in the pub having a pint.
Leaping from tree to tree as they float down the mighty rivers of British Columbia. The giant redwood, the larch, the fir, the mighty Scots pine, the smell of fresh-cut timber, the crash of mighty trees. With my best girlie by my side, we'd sing, sing, sing. I'm a lumberjack and I'm okay. I sleep all night, I work all day.
He's a lumberjack and he's okay. He sleeps all night and he works all day.
We were asked to be Mounties, and so we went along there and were quite surprised at what we found.
Wednesdays I go shopping and have buttered scones for tea.
Not the song. The song is particularly different from anything else we were used to doing, but just the sort of content and the sexual innuendo which we just weren't used to in those days.
I cut down trees, I wear high heels, suspenders and a bra. I wish I'd been a girly, just like my dear mama. I cut down trees, wear high heels, suspenders and a bra.
I think we were all surprised when that last verse did actually appear on screen and didn't horrify the big boys at the BBC.
And I thought you were so rugged!
I've also sung it in German, which was quite extraordinary, because we did a show in Germany.
Ja, ein Holzfäller, der von Baum zu Baum hupft, die auf dem mächtigen Wassen von Südtirol hinabschwimmen.
Michael inadvertently came out and it was hilarious. And we were actually cracking up because he looked exactly like Hitler. And there's Hitler singing with this bunch of Holzfällerein.
Ich fälle Bäume, trag Stöckelschuh und Stumpf und Büstenhalter. War gern ein kleines Mädchen, so wie mein Onkel Walter.
Er fälle Bäume, trägt Stöckelschuh und Strumpf und Büstenhalter.
War gern ein kleines Mädchen, so wie mein Onkel Walter.
Hans, ich dachte, du wärst so männlich.
Spam and the Lumberjack song had set the world on fire. And so, unable to resist the temptations of a rock and roll lifestyle, they were drawn into the recording studio.
The first album was done in André Jacquemin's parents' garden shed, is what it was done in. And there was, at the end of their garden, there was a garden shed, and André had converted it into a tiny little studio. You had to crouch when you went in there.
André's mother, who was wonderful at baking cakes, would keep bringing us these cakes all the time. So we'd just sit there and munch cakes and do a little bit of recording and look at the goldfish pond.
What would happen is that each individually, if they'd wrote a song, they would all have their little tiny cassette recorders and sing into this sort of Walkman.
Marching along with half a bee, singing a song with half a bee. And we'll leave the rest of Fred to do it in his head.
It was really then that the hard work started, actually putting it all together to actually, you know, sort of decipher their meaning of their their melodies and things.
La-dee-dee, a 1, 2, 3, Eric the Half-A-Bee.
Eric the Half-A-Bee was written on location in Germany, outside Munich, when we were filming and with John Cleese, and John was dressed as Little Red Riding Hood, which is an unforgettable sight if you've ever seen John dressed in Bavarian drag.
Eric and I just started to ad lib a little bit together, and my recollection is the song began to come out of that, but it's actually one of my absolute favourites.
A, B, C, D, E, F, G, Eric the Half-A-Bee. Is this a wretched demi-bee, half asleep upon my knee, some freak from a menagerie? No, it's Eric the Half-A-Bee.
For a long time, I thought they were a record act. I had no idea they did a TV show. And I listened to this album, and I was just taken aback. I thought it was stunning. I thought it was hilarious. It's the kind of thing you could listen to over and over and over and over.
The Pythons went on to produce more albums than the Beatles. Well, I mean, you got to include all the compilations, and there's a lot of compilations, but with surprisingly few discs behind them and the royalties rolling in, the Pythons said to themselves, it's time to hit the road.
We did a rather hit-and-miss Python tour of Canada in the early 70s. I think the first time we ever went abroad on stage with Python. And I got to Vancouver and just had to go, it didn't have to sing a word of the Lumberjack song, they went berserk.
Well, now we come to our special gift section. Our contestant tonight is Karl Marx, and our prize is this beautiful lounge suite.
In New York, at the city centre, which was the first time we knew that Python was big there, we came out of the stage door after the first night show, And as we came out the door, there were 100, 200 screaming fans. And I remember this one girl throwing herself at Michael and swooning in his arms.
There was something about what we were doing, I guess, it was anarchic and it was touching, you know, rock and roll sensibilities and anti-authoritarian sensibilities. And we were the comic voice for that at that moment. And so we got the benefit of being treated like rock and roll stars, which is fantastic.
By 1980, Python mania had reached fever pitch in the States. And even the Pythons were not prepared for the groupies who arrived at the Hollywood Bowl.
Well, the Bowl was just fantastic. There were 8,000 people there, and they were just in such a great mood. You know, they were just came to, it was like a fiesta. It was just amazing.
It was a lovely, balmy evening, so there was a lovely feeling of freedom about it. And the crowds were so friendly.
They would have had a good time if we'd just done the phone book, I think. I mean, they're determined to have a good time, you know.
Hey! Hey, man, your cat was a real fish, that she was very, very stable. Oh, come on! Smoothie beggar who can take you under the table. David, you've got our costume, so on our unable. And we can start with a beer. Socrates himself was permanently pissed.
I think we did 4 days. It was just great. And Never Be Rude to an Arab was in. And Sit on My Face.
Sit on my face and tell me that you love me. I love to hear you moralize. When I'm between your thighs, you blow me away.
It's Sing As We Go. Gracie Fields. Sing as we go and rock the world, go by, love, you know. And it's all that kind of World War II. Let's all be jolly nice and coming in tea on Sunday. Gracie would have loved my version, I feel very sure about it.
Sit on my face and let my lips embrace you. I'll sit on your face and let my love you truly. Life can be fine if we're both 69. If we sit on the face of the boss of the best of day, till we're blown away.
Had a wonderful view of that, by the way. I was on the other side of the stage in the wings. I saw all their bottoms. And I can tell you for a fact that has the nicest body.
Turning a British wartime hit into a celebration of oral sex was only the beginning. Terry Jones' first solo performance trod dangerously close to the edge, unsettling his audience with an ironic attack on racist around the world.
Never be rude to an Arab, an Israeli, or Saudi, or Jew. Never be rude to an Irishman, no matter what you do. Never poke fun at a nigger.
After the stage shows and the albums came the movies. And with them, a whole new arena for their music and a whole new bunch of people to outrage. And this time, religious groups around the world managed to be offended by their highly unusual finale.
We were writing The Life of Brian, and we sort of got to the end, and everybody was heading to be crucified. Everybody was going towards death.
So there you are!
I might have known it would end up like this. To think of all the love and affection I've wasted on you. Well, if that's how you treat your poor old mother in the autumn years of her life, all I can say is, go ahead, be crucified. See if I
can. Mum!
We knew we had this end sequence to shoot, and we'd said, oh, it'd be great to do a song and dance routine on the crosses, and we hadn't actually got a song, and I suppose, I don't know, my mind must have been on other things, and then Eric came up with this song. As far as I know, it was a few weeks into the shoot.
I went back and played it and everybody liked the song. I thought, oh, that'll do. Although I don't think Terry liked it much, but anyway.
I remember hearing it and thinking, oh, well, that's all right. I didn't really like it very much, but I suppose it's okay.
And it was, some things in life are bad, and it was sung very straight. I sang it, always look on the bright side. Always look on the bright side of life, is how I sang it. And we got down to Tunisia, and I was playing a character called Mr. Cheeky.
Crucifixion?
No, freedom.
Huh? What?
Freedom for me. They said I hadn't done anything so I could go free and live on an island somewhere.
Oh. Oh, well, that's jolly good. Well, off you go then.
Nah, man, you put in your leg. It's crucifixion, really.
Oh, I see. Yeah, very good. Very
and
good.
I thought, oh, God, that's how the song should... There's something wrong with the song. It needs revocalizing.
Crucifixion?
Yes.
Good.
I just went, some things in life are bad, like a really mucky bed. Other things just make you swear and curse. When you're chewing on last gristle, that grumble, give a whistle. And this'll help things turn out for the best. And always look on the bright side of life. Always look on the light side of life. If life seems jolly rotten, there's something you've forgotten, and that's to laugh and smile and dance and sing. When you're feeling in the dumps, don't be silly chumps. Just purse your lips and whistle, that's the thing. And always look on the bright side of life.
Each cross had to be designed so that the distance between your crotch and your arms was correct. It was all planned perfectly. Each person was going to be, he's there. On the day, Terry changed his mind and started shifting people around, so everybody ended up on the wrong cross, you know, either too short, too long. So the pain was genuine, and it was freezing cold up there. That's what's really bizarre. For some reason, the wind was blowing. We're in our underwear, basically. And I think it's really... a tribute to our professionalism that isn't on film. It seems a joyous occasion.
Just before you draw your terminal breath.
If you look at the sequence, you can see that John, who I may say was the last up on the crosses, I noticed, was also wrapped in a blanket, you know. I said to John, you can't wrap in a blanket. You're meant to be up on a cross, you know. John said, well, I'm going to wear a blanket. I don't care.
And always look on the bright side of life.
Always look on the bright side of life.
I had a friend and he said, you know, Eric, they're starting to sing your song. And I said, what? He said, on the terraces, when they're losing, they start to sing Always Look on the Bright Side. And I said, oh, come on. He said, no, it's true.
It was the very early 90s, about probably 1991. And Manchester United won a big game. And right at the final whistle, you could hear it reverberating around the stadium, always look on the bright side of life. And having known Eric Idle for quite some time, he used to live just round the corner in those days, I gave him a quick call.
After a tip-off from England's number one football player, the rest was history. The single shot up the UK charts, sold thousands of records, and 12 years after the release of Life of Brian, Eric Idle became a pop star.
I think he owes me a few royalties because it went quite high in the charts, didn't it?
That's it.
Why are we here? What's life all about?
In 1983, the Pythons were trusted with their biggest movie yet. Unknown to the others, Terry Jones and Michael Palin were planning to spend the entire budget on one particular song.
The Meaning of Life had, as a sort of framework, birth, life, death, you know, the seven ages of man or whatever, all that sort of thing. And so I suppose we were writing something about birth and about having children. And I think we had the idea of a guy coming back and saying, mill's closed, we're going to have to sell you all for medical experiments.
Valerie, Janine, Martha, Andrew, Thomas, Walter, Pat, Linda, Michael, Evadne, Alice, Dominic and Sasha, it's your bedtime. Now, don't argue!
At the beginning, it was kind of important to get this family, you've got the mother and the father, and this family of 67 children. And so it's very important to see the mother surrounded by all these children.
Laura, Alfred, Nigel, Annie, Simon...
Wait! I've got something to tell the whole family.
Oh, quick, go and get the others in, Gordon.
And, you know, he sang this rather sentimental song, which I suppose is sort of, at the time, must have been our feelings about the Catholic teaching on contraception.
You're a Catholic the moment Dad came, because every sperm is sacred, every sperm is great. If a sperm is wasted, God gets quite irate.
Every sperm is sacred, every sperm is great. If a sperm is wasted, God gets quite irate.
I had absolutely no idea what I was talking about. I mean, I had... Obviously, I understood the words, all bar one, I think, that being the famous sperm word.
In du Taoist moment, spill there's just anywhere. But God loves those who treat their semen with more care.
Every sperm is safe.
We had the children going out of the house, and then the guys in the... And the loos.
If a sperm is wasted,
we had various sort of street scenes, and we just had sort of a whole array of images that we shot in different places and spun together. There was the nursemaids pushing the prams with the cardinals in it. I don't know quite why, but it seemed to make sense at the time.
Your neighborhood.
Every sperm is useful.
It was going to be like something from Oliver.
Everybody's
mine
and mine
and mine.
He'd drawn all of the camera angles and exactly what he wanted to see, like all the nannies in their prams, the angles, how many he'd wanted to see, the nuns, he'd drawn the leading nun.
Let the pagans feel there's a mountain hill and plain.
So I would have to, like, in one bar or eight bars or 12 bars, choreograph movement to his drawings. As a choreographer, it was one of the best times in my life. The best, the very, very best.
It had to be done with enormous gusto for it to work at all. And what I think made it into one of my favourites of all the Python songs was, I suppose, the production, the sheer scale of it, the number of people we had to sing it, the marvellous choreography, the fact the camera was going up and down, you know, things we could never afford to do in any of the previous films. Put on a big Hollywood production number, and I'm very, very proud of it.
I can hear you screaming, no! Those aren't the greatest hits. Well, give me a break. Greatest hits LPs are always a disappointment. But those are some of Python's own favorites, and who are we to argue with them? But of course, there are many more jewels in the crown. Knights of the Round Table, Finland, I Like Chinese, and this beautiful little song. Take it away, Mr. Idol.
The universe itself keeps on expanding and expanding in all of the directions it can whiz. As fast as it can go, the speed of light you know, 12 million miles a minute, and that's the fastest speed there is. So remember when you're feeling very small and insecure, how amazingly unlikely is your birth. And pray that there's intelligent life somewhere out in space, 'cause there's bugger all down here on Earth.
Thank you.
Good evening, viewer. Tonight, BBC Two is...
One!
BBC Two is particularly pleased to welcome to the studio the entire surviving Monty Python team. Now, this is something of a special occasion because it's the first time in 25 years that the entire Python team has been assembled in a studio like this. So, welcome Michael Palin.
Good evening.
Terry Jones. John Cleese.
Hello.
Terry Gilliam.
Hello.
And by satellite from America, Eric Idle.
Good evening.
Well, thank you all for coming into the studio tonight.
Oh, not at all.
Not at all.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
I thought that went rather well, didn't you?
Yes.
You fancy a drink?
Yes, what have you got there?
Not a lot.
Waste of time.
What am I going to do with my brain?
Oh, dear. No more. No more bricks.
What is N? What is N? N.
That was the end of Monty Python. And now the BBC is closing down. Forever.